those 10 years since the publication of the framework, it occurs to me, represent only about a quarter of the whole period over which the framework itself has been evolving. If I'm not mistaken, you've been involved in the whole period. How would you characterise your own involvement?
Well, of course, from 1971 through to 1997, I was directing in one form or another the modern language projects of the Council of Europe. And my role there, as I saw it, was partly to give leadership in the general framework of ideas and the general approach to be used. And secondly, to coordinate the efforts of a very large number of people across Europe of very different backgrounds and, in many cases, different approaches.
Mm-hmm. And how did that role fit into the work of the Council of Europe, more generally, would you say?
Well, very well, I think, because unlike the European Union, for example, the Council of Europe has no directive powers. It is not an independent body or a body that stands above governments. It is a mechanism for cooperation between the member governments. And of course, there are now well over 40 governments across the whole of Europe. And so the Council of Europe must work by consensus. And any recommendations that it makes must carry the backing of all its members. Mm-hmm. The strong opposition of any one member can frustrate its developments. And so a great deal of work is done by a very small secretariat to prepare the decisions made by the member governments. But it is the direction given by the member governments themselves that really matter. And so there is no way in which the Council of Europe can try to make people do things it doesn't want to do. And I have never tried to establish mechanisms that make people do what they don't want to do. I've tried to find the way in which very different, even opposing points of view can contribute in their own way to an overall positive forward development.
Okay, well, that's very interesting. I think we'll pick that point up a bit later and look at some of the recommendations which have come out from the Council of Europe about the uses of the framework,
yes,
perhaps in the last 10 years, in the period we've been looking at. But picking up that idea of you as a coordinator of activities from the early 70s through to the early 90s, as a result of that, you were the coordinating author and editor of the published version of the CEFR in English. Can you briefly summarise what the roles were in the team that put together that volume?
Yes. Well, of course, we worked together as a team of three authors, Brian North, Daniel Cost, and myself. And we took responsibility then for the whole thing as it emerged, but we had different roles, obviously, within it. We worked together on the first two chapters of the framework, agreeing on its overall function, the criteria it had to satisfy, and the basic action-oriented approach, which we summarized in one particular paragraph, which is central to the whole document. Then individually, I worked mainly on the taxonomy of language use and language competence. What a mature, competent speaker of the language is expected to be able to do with the language, and what knowledge and skills he or she requires in order to be able to do that. Brian North worked particularly on the scales of proficiency, which were very important to the member governments in asking for the framework, and particularly backed by the Swiss government, which put money into the research project, which filtered out from existing descriptor statements and existing scales a set which were easily interpretable, particularly by teachers.
So that's what led to the global scale, yes, of the six levels.
That's right.
Supported by the illustrative scales,
yes,
or all couched in the can-do model.
That's right. Mm-hmm. And because, in fact, the existing scales which were drawn upon were also basically of a can-do variety, even though they might not use the words can-do. Mm-hmm. And then Daniel Kost was particularly concerned with questions of curricular development.